straight away. Questions, but before that, because he raised this issue, 91st Amendment is about broadly two things. Limiting the size of the cabinet or council of ministers. Earlier there was no limit. You remember when before you, most of you were born, Mr. Anjaya was chief minister, we had 90 ministers in Andhra Pradesh. You know, just to, and then there were another 50 or 60 fellows who were chairman of corporations and things like that. I think in Arunachal Pradesh, I think at that time, out of 46 members of the ruling party, 44 were ministers. Who were the other two? Speaker and deputy speaker. So it's gone really to ridiculous length. So at least this amendment limits the size of the council of ministers to 15% of the strength of the house. I wanted 10%, but finally a compromise was struck. The other part is strengthening the anti-defection provisions. Earlier the constitution said if one third of the members defect, it's perfectly all right. Now that was tightened to say nothing of the kind. But on the whole, I'm not happy with that part of the amendment because of other consequences. We'll not go into that now. The 99th amendment, somebody mentioned, that is about higher judiciary appointments, High Court, Supreme Court judges. That was quashed by Supreme Court wrongly, unconstitutionally, in a self-serving order. So after a massive effort, for years and years, we ultimately lost the battle in the short term. But I'm sure, eventually, our argument is that no authority in a constitutional democracy must appoint itself. Ultimately, all power is and must be traced to the people. You may like politicians, may not like politicians, doesn't matter. It's the people, by their willing consent, give the authority to those in power. Nobody gives authority to himself or herself. So on that logic, we have argued, no? Your own Supreme Court justice's appointment right now, the process is going on. The president nominates, the Senate confirms, but ultimately the president is elected, the Senate is elected. So they, in return, are accountable to the people. So unless you trace that power to an elected body, that power is illegitimate. But, well, given India's conditions, it's a, you know, a complex thing. So for the time being, though we were right, I'm absolutely certain in the long term we will prevail on that issue. But for the time being, the court unconstitutionally and immorally quashed it. But what do you do? You don't want a showdown between Parliament and the Supreme Court and a crisis in the country. The third of the amendment is a successful one, but the impact will be felt in years and decades. That is, giving cooperatives as a form of organization, you know how farmers' cooperatives in the US, etc., complete autonomy, so that the governments cannot fire them at will and control them. So far, that's what's happening. That's already implied in the Constitution, but it was violated by both by the courts and the government. And therefore, Article 19(1)(c) of the Constitution was amended at my behest to give cooperatives the same protection as to associations, societies, etc., and to trade unions. That apart, you mentioned two or three laws. There are several other laws we've been instrumental in getting. And of course, several policy changes, but all this is nothing compared to what needs to be done. I want us all to remind ourselves of that, because if we rest on our laurels, probably we accomplished more than any other group in India. Doesn't mean much. I'm not impressed. We should be impressed only when India's trajectory changes. The future of most of our citizens is in right shape, and we have the governing instruments and incentives in place. Doesn't matter which party is governing. Until that time, I think our task is largely unfinished, and we should strive. So, this is just to clarify. The floor is yours now. I don't think I should give a speech or something. Just now, by the way, I was returning from a meeting, all of us, with Professor Darling Hammond of the Stanford University, a public policy expert and particularly working in education. She said something very well known, but I think it's important to remind ourselves of that. She said, our neuronal networks in the brain, there all those associations are formed only when the kid is engaged, not when a teacher simply gives a lecture and gives some papers. It's not merely kids. All of us require this engagement for the process to move on. Otherwise, it will be a nice lecture. Purana kalakshep antare. We think that we heard, nobody hears anything. That I'm convinced. We have to really be engaged. That's the only way we move forward. So, please make it an interactive one. However difficult the question you think is, as long as it's related to some aspect of public governance of India, so that we don't waste our time on films or some other thing. No, I'm not saying they're bad. But we're discussing something about the collective of India. So not cricket, not films. But as long as it's related to that, let's explore that. Okay, the floor is yours now. Just give me your name, where you come from in India, just half a sentence, where you're working currently, so that I can relate to you a little better. Okay? Anybody? Will somebody sort of coordinate, because my eye will not catch everybody. No, if you or somebody sits here, then you can see who is sort of raising hands. Otherwise, I'll miss them. And please.
Thank you, JP, for coming. My name is Abhijit Bose, and I'm an entrepreneur here for almost 2 decades in the Valley. I'm from Delhi, originally from Bengal. My last name probably gives it away. The question that I have is, what are the top 3 things in terms of policy that needs to be changed for invigorate India from ground up? And this follow-up question is, part of democracy is, the problem is when it runs well, people become lethargic, they're lazy and they're easy-going people. And that leads to other problems, which is we see in America today. So it's not only just getting the things fixed, but how you keep it sustainable over the period of time. What kind of policy needs to start?
Great question, Sajit. Actually, Kalyan anticipated your question and he asked me to make a presentation on three issues. I suspected actually for a moment. he mentioned, and I broadly concur, education, healthcare, and rule of law, or local governance. All three are absolutely critical. In fact, if there's only one I have to ask for, I would say, there's a God and he appears before us and says, pardon me for saying he, that's a sexist slur. But no, whatever the gender, be God's gender, appears and asks us, we would say education, but in a broad sense, meaningful sense. But healthcare and local governance, I broadly concur, but also service delivery. Because no, even the most basic things that you take for granted in dealing with government in this country, county level, state level, federal level, or city level, they simply don't happen in India, most cases. We all know that. And it's not impossible, there's a way of making it happen. Then rule of law. On paper, we have the same rule of law as the United States. On paper. But in reality, again, I don't have to explain to you. We all gone through that, we understand that. And I would also say agriculture. There's a lot that needs to be done. So the broader point is there are specific deliverable reforms, very practical, acceptable, affordable, simple. Why are they not happening? Honestly, I can't answer that easily, except the way I strip it. As a culture, as a political system, as a governing system, as a elite system. Because somebody, a bright youngster called Viraya, a medical doctor, trained in Britain, came to the United States, is now working as a cardiologist somewhere, I think, in the Midwest or North, or somewhere. He asked me a simple question. He said, how come education and healthcare are not vote getters in India? I mean, what makes political parties and governments not improve them and then seek votes? Honestly, I'm flummoxed. I have no answer. It doesn't make any sense to me, except that the parties and governments have lost faith in their own capacity to actually bring about change. Therefore, they don't think that if they make an effort there, there will be political dividends. And therefore, they are doing the easy things. I give you free power, I give you free TV, that happened in some states. I give you 100 other freebies because they feel there's an instant gratification and that they will be rewarded in terms of vote immediately. Well, that's how democracies function, but it's a tragedy that there are other deliverables which are vote getters and not attempted. And that's what we all should force the system to focus on. Yes, sir.
My name is Vindyut and I work for Apple here. I've been here in Bay Area last 4 years. So, like, I had two questions. One is with regards to, like, you know, I see a lot of your videos and been following from years. Like, so you always talk about the proportionate system of, you know, electing the representatives, and also, like, you know, electing directly the CM instead of, like, legislators. I would like, I get the gist of the idea, but, like, I can't really understand the details. Like, how does that work? Like, will it be like local MLAs, or like it'll be based on like some districts? I don't understand. That's my first question. And second question is,
shall we address this and then come
sure,
back? Otherwise,
no
I will lose focus.
Yeah.
I think it's a good opportunity to sort of look at these things. First, I was would like to preface my comments with a broad statement that actually, the electoral system does not guarantee any outcomes, good or bad. There is no one system which is good. It is all contextual. The UK has a first-past-the-post system and they are doing pretty well. What is the meaning of pretty well? Is it a subjective statement? No, I never make subjective statements as a general rule. I always try and create some measurable yardsticks. I have four yardsticks for politics in any country, in a democratic society. Yardstick one, is the system attracting the finest talent? Is it hospitable to the best and the brightest in the society to come and play a very creative and meaningful role in the public space? Yardstick two, if they are indeed attracted, does the system allow ethically a rise of the best to the top? Doesn't matter what ideas. You have one idea today, tomorrow some other idea prevails. But ethically and rationally, by ethical and rational means, can they reach the top? Not necessarily the president itself, but no, decision-making positions anywhere, everywhere, at every level. Yardstick three, does the system offer to the people real and genuine alternatives in terms of policies and ideas and programs? Or is it tweedledum and tweedledee? Yardstick four, once a group is elected to office at city level, local level, state or national level, is the group empowered adequately to deliver on the promises made? Because that's the mandate they obtained. I'm not looking at any ideological thing, I'm looking at practical things. After all, we built a system in order to get the collective things to be done, which we can't do at our home or at our family level. So these, to my mind, are the four simple yardsticks, rules of thumb. In Britain, by and large, all these four are delivered. It attracts the best. They are elected without resorting to either irrational or unethical means, by and large. They offer genuine alternatives of policy and program. And they actually have the capacity to deliver. In India, almost none of these four is holding true. And therefore, you must look at the best ways to make it happen. Therefore, it's not because a system is bad, another system is good. I want you to really understand. Most people know we have very facile notions about what is right, what is wrong. There's nothing right or wrong in this. Given that, how do you quickly alter the incentives in politics? Proportionality model is primarily aimed at that. Because today, you blame the political parties, very easy to blame, Congress, BJP, TDP, TRS, any party. But once they are in the first past the post system, they have their own imperatives. They have to, by hook or crook, win the constituency. The fellow who gets the most votes in the constituency is the winner. The fellow who gets the most MLAs or MPs is the fellow in government. It's as simple as that. You may give all kinds of speeches, at the end of the day, that's what matters. Therefore, the incentive is completely different. The marginal vote becomes all important because I don't know where my winning vote is coming from. That's why either paying money for the votes in a poor country, after all, money matters. In a state like Andhra Pradesh or Telangana or Karnataka, typically a family gets in an election about 7,000-8,000 rupees. There are two or three voters, there are two or three candidates, each paying 1,000-2,000 per vote. It's not uncommon, these numbers. You're looking at 7,000-8,000 rupees in a desperately poor country in one election. It's easy for you and me to moralize. But why is there the incentive to spend that kind of money? Because I have to get the marginal vote. Even if otherwise my agenda, my credibility, my party gives me X vote, unless that X plus vote is there, I will not be electable. In a proportionality model, simply put, without going into too many technical details, they are very technical details, but they are important for us. If the seats, number of seats in legislature are proportional to the vote share in the state, let us say, then I don't care if I lose 100 votes or gain 100 votes, it's not that important. Overall, am I gaining acceptability and higher share of vote rather than, my God, 100 votes I lost and I lost power. Therefore, the incentive to buy the vote has largely disappeared. The second part of that is no single candidate is a winner. It's a list. Therefore, why should I, in order to get you elected, spend money to buy the vote? Incentive again is altered. So there are of course again certain safeguards necessary because it may fragment the polity, therefore some threshold is required. But fundamentally, how do you quickly alter the incentive in politics instead of blaming politicians? We all love to blame our politicians, but they are victims of a vicious game. How do you alter the game itself? State level, direct election, is for two reasons. Again, for the same reason significantly, because if I am to be elected for the whole state as opposed to 294 or 175 or 119 constituencies, then the incentive to buy to that extent is reduced. It's cheaper and easier to carry the people by your track record and agenda and charisma than to buy the vote. Whereas if you fragment it to 100 constituencies, it's better to buy each constituency separately because there are players who are willing to spend that kind of money because you'll become an MLA. That's what's happening now. Whereas in a direct election, if you are the executive, one, that incentive diminishes. Two, the person elected does not have to compromise every day in dealing with MLAs. Many leaders of all parties, they find this now. Most of their energy is wasted.